involved is because Cambridge considers the bicycle to be part of the transportation network. Mm-hmm. And that's even from a legal point of view. There have been laws that have said pedestrians and bicyclists are part of the community. Mm-hmm. And in the work that the bike committee has done, which is probably one of the longest running citizen advisory committees in the state, we've really worked to make every road a bike-friendly road. Mm-hmm. And bring bicyclists to the places where they want to go safely and conveniently. Right, and those are our goals.
Right, and Cambridge is, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but Cambridge is known as sort of on the forefront in terms of bicycle, just integrating bikes into general traffic decisions.
It's definitely our goal.
Yeah. Cambridge is leading the way in this Commonwealth right now.
Yeah, yeah. I called you guys up not knowing really what you do. So what, you know, tell us a little bit about what are your activities? I mean, when you, as part of the Somerville Committee, what are the things that you're out there wondering about and working on?
Well, Somerville, like Cambridge, and like a lot of the inner suburbs of Boston, very densely populated, narrow streets, and while we all love paths and off-road riding, the fact of the matter is we have to ride on the streets. And so one of the things that cyclists in Somerville have been trying to do is to look at ways that the city can be made more bikeable. And part of it is just raising awareness. We have an American Automobile Association, and you know, hundreds of thousands of people are driving in and out of cities every day. And so one of the things that local committees, like what Michael is doing and what Conrad's doing on the state level, is just increasing awareness. Right. Of bicycle use and the fact that, again, it's not just a recreational thing. Right. I'm amazed I shouldn't be amazed, but every day, practically, I see people riding to maybe their work at a gas station. They're not dressed up in spandex and Lycra. Right. I mean, people in blue jeans, or they've got coats on, or they're, you know, it's obviously that they're working people.
Yeah.
But it's all classes of people. It's not just college students. It's not just an upper middle class or middle class thing. Everybody rides bikes. And so if we can increase that awareness, get into the schools, have safety taught, bicycle rodeos, mm-hmm. and then get into the streets and see, you know, what works and what doesn't. Bike mm-hmm. lanes. Cambridge is doing a great job with introducing bike lanes to the near Boston area.
And you're also saying that when, like, say, an intersection is sort of redesigned or it's up to be, you know, redesigned, mm-hmm. and you would get involved, or you'd like to get involved anyway, in how it's actually built up so that, you know, a cyclist could get through there easily without, you know, risking his or her life.
Well, one of the words I like to throw out, the big $50 word, is institutionalization. And basically what that means is that you've got traffic engineers who are looking at how the automobile moves on the road. You've got a traffic and parking department. What you really need to have is a bicycle coordinator, somebody who's in the transportation department end of things, or the engineering end of things, who can say, well, gee, you know, when this street is being redesigned, such as Mass Ave from Porter Square up to Arlington is going to happen within a year or so. Mm-hmm. The Cambridge Bike Committee got in there and they said, okay, you know, where do we put bike lanes in? You know, can we make that happen? Mm-hmm. And it's going to happen on Mass Ave. And right. The same thing can happen on a lot of streets. Mm-hmm. So if you're out there riding on the street and you see a problem, I like to say you can do more than just whine and complain about it. There are people you can talk to say, hey, you know, that sewer grate is turned the wrong way and bicycle tire could get caught in it, right? Mm-hmm. Or, you know, bicycles have a difficult time getting through this intersection. You know, what's the timing? You know, what's the layout of the lanes or whatever? Mm-hmm. The little things that people can do to get involved, and I think that's where local committees like Somerville and Cambridge can sort of be part of the mix and talk to the engineers and the mayor and the city council, things like that.
Is that going on right now in Somerville?
To some extent. We're very fortunate. We have a liaison in City Hall, and he's an advocate. His name is Todd Fontanella, and he's part of his charge in community development is working with transportation. One of the things that we're going to see in Somerville is more bicycle racks installed on the part of the city. Cambridge has pioneered what's called the post and ring. It looks like a parking meter with a ring around it. And Somerville's going to get some money to have some of those made installed throughout the city.
Right, because right now in Cambridge, they pay for half of it?
Right. It's a deal that Cambridge has. It's a public-private partnership that if a business wants to have this parking facility, this post and a ring put in front of their building, the city will do the installation and will pay for half of it. And that's sort of like getting extra parking for for the place. The nice thing, just to take what Greg said about institutionalization, the next step is what's great about our committee and how Cambridge is working, and you know, things aren't all goodness and light everywhere. There's always room for improvement. But the great thing is that the a lot of the people who design the roads now aren't back in the 50s where it seems like a lot of America still is. They design roads to take into account not just the convenience of the driver, but everyone, the safety and convenience of everyone. And it was great. I was in Central Square several weeks ago, and I was watching traffic, and lo and behold, the director of traffic and parking came by me on her bike. That's something we can all hope, not just that, which is great, though, that if we can say, there's a grate that's turned the wrong way, please fix it, but to not have it there, put there in the first place. Right. That's even better because the people understand the issues. And I think that really helps make communities better, like what Conrad was saying. A bike-friendly community is a people-friendly community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. One thing, you mentioned a couple of trails that you're working on. Do you want to just sort of, if we could get a shot of just show a couple of the trails that are going on in Somerville. It's pretty exciting stuff for someone who's a commuter to, say, Boston. You want to go through it?
Well, what we have here, this is a map of Somerville. Cambridge is down here. This is Arlington. Medford's up here. And this is the Mystic River, which is one of Somerville's natural boundaries. A lot of people don't realize. There's a path that goes behind. This is the Assembly Square Mall. There's a path that runs along the Mystic River up into Medford, and then over here where the Alewife Brook Parkway is, there's some asphalt paths that run along the Arlington-Somerville border here. Someday these may all be connected and improved and be nice facilities. This is the Charlestown-Somerville border right up here. And the MBTA bus barn is just on the other side of a chain link fence, and you can see your way over to Route 99, which is a major connector road that takes you over towards the heart of Charlestown. There's hopefully we're going to be able to see a connector at some point across the river there, or along the river down to the Sullivan Square area, and you'll have a sort of a route that follows these wonderful riverways and beautiful parkland here too. This is probably our most exciting concept. This is what we're sort of calling the Central Somerville Bikeway. We see it as one of the possible extensions of the Minuteman. The Alewife T station is down here. This is where the Minuteman begins. Davis Square, you are here, Union Square, that's where we are right now. City Hall and the library. The Linear Park, which is actually over the Red Line Tunnel, takes you to Davis Square. There's a new short extension of a bikeway on old freight right-of-way, abandoned freight right-of-way, that takes you up to Cedar Street, this street right here. At this point, there's live rail that runs down to North Station. It's wide enough. It was built back in the turn of the century with four tracks.
But that's the commuter rail.
That's the commuter rail. This goes up to Lowell. Yeah. Two are used. There's a lightly used freight rail track on one side, and then the other side is empty. We feel that there's a possibility of putting a trail fenced off from the commuter rail following this all the way to North Station. This is Lechmere down here. It would go right through the center of the city. It would be the quickest way to get from the end of the Minuteman down to North Station. You'd have ramps that would come down to up and down from the bridges overhead. It's actually a very green corridor. If you ever go out there over look at those bridges, you get a great view of Boston as you get further into towards town.
Totally direct too.
Yeah, and where this is right now is that the city feels that maybe it can be built pieces at a time.
Right.
This is a freight spur. This may be abandoned in a couple of years. If that happens, that they could build up to Lowell Street.
Mm-hmm.
There'd have to be a feasibility done by the state. We would definitely have to work with the T. But we feel it can be done, and within our lifetimes, we think that there's a real possibility that this, what's called a rail with trail, could be built all the way into town.
And there would be fences and that sort of thing.
Yeah, it'd be fenced, might be lighted. You'd certainly take into account that you're going through a city, so you'd think about, you know, what are the safety concerns. But as one of the things that this does is it adds open space to a really densely built city, and Somerville just does not have a lot of open space.
Sure.
So you'd be able to use it as a commuter route, recreation, hiking, jogging, things like that.
And it's extension to the Minuteman as well.
Exactly, And this is just one of a network of paths throughout the Boston area. And I know you've got another map over there that you're going to get into. But this is within the realm of possibility, just like a lot of the more bucolic paths out in the suburbs.
Right.
Yeah, I think that what needs to be stressed is that bike paths are not for hardcore bike riders. Bike paths are for kids, for families, really rejuvenate town centers, which have really been, in my opinion, economically raided by malls and suburbs.
Right.
And they really restore commerce as well as anything.
Mm-hmm.
So this would be a tremendous asset.
Yeah, and any citizen of Somerville, Cambridge, who's been on the Minuteman on a sunny afternoon just sees the entire community walking out there and whatever, rollerblading, biking, whatever, just out in the community, which is rare.
Your daily commute, the ends of the Minuteman right now is sort of like the Shel Silverstein book where the sidewalk ends, except where the bike path ends. You have all these people there like, well, now what do we do? my sister is one of them who would love to ride her bike all the way into her downtown Boston job.
Right.
She's too intimidated by the traffic and notably the bus drivers on Mass Ave.
Oh, yeah.
Which have really intimidated her right out of cycling. So she stops at Alewife now.
Right.
But she would love to continue. This would do it.
Mm-hmm. Right, yeah. It would be great. It really would be. Mike, why don't you tell us a little bit about what Cambridge does in terms of your activities. I mean, I know one thing I definitely want to talk about is bike cops, police on bicycles. I mean, Somerville has them too. I ran into one the other day.
Actually, they're more around more than you think. I mean, they're really just about everywhere now in the metropolitan area. It's wonderful to see this.
And actually, Somerville currently has more bike cops than Cambridge does. Strangely enough,
okay.
The Cambridge is building up their force, but our bike cops are currently the people who are what they're probably known to in the bike community. They're also enforcing some of the bicycle regulations that apply for the most part throughout the state, but almost no one else is enforcing them.
Right.
And some people come to our meetings and they say, well, we're here because we really want to help you fight these bike laws.
Mm-hmm.
And they're quite surprised to find out that our committee has actually been very supportive of the enforcement.
Right.
And people don't understand that. And the reasoning for us is that if you believe that laws don't apply to you, it's very hard to turn to them for protection. And once you acknowledge the fact that you are a part of the road, that you have responsibilities, you get to take your rights more seriously.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that the bike cops, the people who are out on the beat doing 50 miles a day, are the ones who are doing the enforcement, means they have some perspective on what it means to be a bicyclist. They're not just someone who sits in a cruiser the whole time.
Right.
So, in some ways, it's not the best use of bike cops because they're trained to do things that people in cars can't, but it really does give them extra perspective. Mm-hmm. There have been some high-profile cases in Cambridge where people have accused the police of maybe going too far, and it's really hard to tell the specifics of what happens. But one of the members of the bike patrol is on our committee and talks to us about exactly how enforcement is done, and mm-hmm. we can talk to him. And mm-hmm. and in my opinion, it's actually done a lot to improve the safety of bicyclists because they realize that some of the things they're doing actually endangers not just themselves but others.
Mm-hmm.
And it really improves the safety for other people like pedestrians,
right.
who in the middle of Central Square, having people riding quickly down the sidewalk really is a jeopardy. And that's something that actually pushed a lot of the discussion about enforcement.
Right.
But I think inevitably it'll be good for everyone, including bicyclists.
Right, yeah. And it was very controversial that cops were actually handing out citations for riding on sidewalks and in squares and that sort of thing.
Right. That enforcement part is sort of the three E's of Cambridge, which is education, enforcement, and engineering. Mm-hmm. Building the stuff on the street to both make it safer and acknowledge the fact that bikes are part of the road community. Educating people how to use them and what's the safest way to ride, and doing enforcement to bring that point home.
Right, right. Is that something that, that Mass Bike is involved in at all?
Well, definitely. Yeah. Sure. I mean, we don't work on the local level, but one of the things I did want to say is that we acknowledge the good work that has been done by the existing committees, and one of the things we've been trying to do in the last year is to foster new committees and nurture the fledgling ones, because we are one of our goals is to have a committee in every town, every one of the 351 right. towns and communities in the Commonwealth, because then it's that's really where it has to happen. You have right. to have local people who care about what happens in their community. So mm-hmm. our conference last fall was specifically about helping to develop more bicycle committees.
Right.
So yes.
Yeah. And also, this is, like you said, everyone rides their bike. I mean, a lot of people ride their bikes, and these aren't like elected officials or anything, right? These right. are you. This is just sort of you show.
Well, no, I mean, there are elected officials out there riding too.
No, I meant that in terms of your committees. I mean, anyone can show up at your meetings. Right. Is what I mean to say.
Although, there are different kinds of committees. For instance, what Cambridge has, they have an officially appointed group of people.
It's part of the Department of
exactly
something.
Right. Community development right. under the city manager appoints us, so right. we are official representatives. And people from the public can comment. Right. We also have representatives from Department of Public Works, from Traffic and Parking, and from the police.
Right.
So it's interesting that Greg used a great word before, which was institutionalization. And you talk about cops on bikes. Now, as you would remember, 10, 20 years ago, the guys would show up at the planning meeting with, they look like Sputnik, with lights flashing and reflective tape, and everybody's thinking, we're going to listen to this guy. Cops on bikes. New York City has 1,200 bike cops. I mean, nobody is really more politically powerful than cops. When right. you really look at how dollars are allocated, and also it's where the rubber meets the road of law enforcement, and the other group is the DPW guys. You look at how hard we worked on a House Bill 1940, and the guy gets out there, it's 4:30, he's got to get home. Well, forget the bike lane today, and they just pave.
Tell me.
1940 is, there's a state law that's basically saying we're supposed to be making the roads wide enough to accommodate other people than just the cars. Well, a lot of roads have been repaved, and this is, I don't know where it's been done yet.
Well, I can talk about that.
But that's a whole separate issue. But that's a statewide initiative, a beautiful law, right. where people worked very hard to pass, Ann Paulson out of Belmont.
Mm-hmm.
But what is happening is this institutionalization. These are fathers, these are mothers, these are suburban people, mm-hmm. these are city people, and it's the cops are the ones that are really the mainstream conservative force. It is no longer a bunch of hippies in hemp skirts making this happen. Right. It's now, and that was me. I mean, not the skirt, but but now this is, and it's a wonderful thing. It appeals to very liberal people. It appeals to very conservative people. The bicycle appeals to so many different strands of society.
And just to note that bike cops don't just police bikers. I mean, they're cops. You know, they do their job. You know,
no, if I'm not mistaken, I've seen a cop. I've seen a mounted meter. Several times, and cops they can cover and monitor the meters quite a bit faster on a bike than they can. So I thought it was great. They're out there ticketing cars on a bike.
The cops aren't out there because they think they look great on bikes, and this is sort of the in thing to do. They're out there because
it helps
them do the job. Yeah. They can be better cops. They can be better law enforcement. They can be places where they can't be in a cruiser or on a motorcycle.
Right.
Yeah, just to pick up on the community theme, I mean, the force behind that is what's called community policing, and they've recognized that a person, a cop, but somebody on a bicycle is much more accessible and much more connected to the community than the guy who sits in the cruiser and maybe looks out the window. So the cops love it because it feels that they feel that they have a connection with the people all around them that they didn't have before.
Right. And it costs less than cruisers. I mean, imagine this, we're spending less money. Look at all the money that's been thrown at DARE programs that has proven to be nothing, it hasn't done anything. Cops on Bike is saving money for police forces in more ways than just the cost of a cruiser. Mm-hmm. Health benefits, and the cops are lining up. There's waiting lists on a lot of, these guys are under stress, and there are waiting lists to be the bike cops now.
Right.
And the first guys who did it were all laughed at.
Right.
One of the extensions of bike hops that we're even working on in Cambridge is taking the idea of a citizen's crime watch, which is normally a neighborhood, and put it on bikes. Have people who ride around the city with cell phones that go back to the police station, and if they see something happening, they can call in. Mm-hmm. It sort of spreads the idea of keep your neighborhood safe over a wider area and brings bicyclists who are not always considered as really integrated in the community, mm-hmm. and really helps them answer their community goals and tries to bring their ideas and what they believe that community is important to the broader community, right. So that everyone sees it.
Right. It is definitely a big move, I think. I agree. I'd like to switch gears a little bit here, having gotten that sort of the local feel. And talk about bike trails, specifically rail trails, which, you know, again, to people who have ridden on the Minuteman or on other trails around the state or even around the country, you can see they really can be a beautiful thing. They're really great in terms of community. It's just great to have that trail to bike safely down the road. But there are a lot of people who are very much against it. Typically people who are butters, they don't like that so much.
Well, you shouldn't say there are a lot of people.
There
certainly is a vocal minority,
right.
And you know, the history of railroads and the way they got the right-of-way to begin with, and the abandonment over the years, mm-hmm. as tracks become disused, it can be a very volatile thing. And here in Massachusetts, we've had a pretty good run with converting old railroad lines to trails, but there have been a couple of highly publicized recent cases.
Right.
And there's it's a very, they're individual situations, and I just want to say that we shouldn't feel like there's this massive force
right.
that's against
right.
them.
Right.
But it behooves us to sort of be out in front and explain why.
Yeah.
These
yeah.
are valuable.
It's a very contentious issue. I, on Conrad's invitation, I went to a meeting in Danvers where there's discussion of a trail, and we have a tape of just some people talking about, you know, their concerns. So we can just run it just a couple of minutes. After that, there's going to be just a tape of sort of montage of the Minuteman Trail, and to just sort of show for people who are watching tonight who haven't been out there, or haven't seen it on a sort of warm, sunny day, just to get a feel for who's out there, how many people are out there, and then a couple of interviews with some people. So if we could run that tape now, I think that would be great.
Children or whatever, feel like I'm on display by people coming through the backyard, and I live even closer than Rick, and Rick's probably 20, I'm like 20 feet. Mm-hmm. I actually own part of the easement.
I think the best thing to do, if you really want to know what it's like to have one in your backyard, is to go to Bristol, go to these other places, and knock on a door. Somebody that's in a situation similar to yours. It's 10 feet away. And if they tell you it sucks, then you can come back here and say, you know, I'm not going to do that, or at least you'll be in a better position. If they say it's great, it might, you know, help you come for a second. Because I've got neighbors that are totally opposed to it. You know, they come to me and say, you know, come on, come with us, we want to stop this thing. And they, you know, give me some scare type stuff, and you know, you have people coming in, they're grabbing their piece of cars and run off down the trail and all that. Well, they can do that in the front too, you know what I mean? The fact of the matter is, I think if it's used a lot, it's less likely to happen. That's just the way I feel about it.
Yeah.
But I was on the fence, because I don't really know. It is a risk. I just built this house 2 years ago. I spent a lot of my money. I want it to improve. I don't want it to get worse. After seeing this presentation right now, I'm all psyched up. But I'm still going to go out there and knock on some doors before I decide whether I'm going to go to the next meeting and say, this is a great thing, and I live there. Mm-hmm. Put my money where my mouth is. Or whether I'm going to be opposed to it.
Well, maybe you should have an organized tour sponsored by the whatever group is here.
Unfortunately, the guy on my street who's most opposed to it isn't here.
I know. I saw him walk out.
I gave those leaflets out.
I saw him walk out, and I'm kind of upset.
Bikes, and I leafleted my neighborhood. Said, well, let's go and find out what's going on.
Yeah. Well,
no one here except my next-door neighbor was here, and then he left. So that's kind of unfortunate. There's no information.
Well, it doesn't surprise me that it happened, because it's sort of scripted, and certain things happen in certain ways. But I'm glad there are some people that or ambivalent state. Okay, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I like to see the bike paths when they're in view of the people, you know, not behind the houses. You know, up the open where you can see maybe kids driving by the bike. Mm-hmm. Some towns have that, mm-hmm. like down the Cape. Yep. You can see everybody riding their bike, which is good. But you put them in these backyards. I was talking to a lady, she's from Maryland. She said they had bike paths in Maryland. Her son lived down there. And he was saying that they pumped it up to Baltimore, the bike paths. And now they're in trouble in their town. From these, everybody's riding from everybody else to everybody's town. There's a going problem there. And this dam is so congested. We can't even cross the street here. We can't get across the street. We don't have room, I don't think, for the, you know, the bypass out in the open.
You think it's possible that a lot of the traffic is caused by Danvers residents going to the stores who may,
yeah,
may be using...
We don't have streets anymore.
Everybody talks about not my backyard. You know, there's nothing wrong with that because everybody's entitled to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And your home and your land are not.
For, I guess, for other people who might want to have these bike paths, would you recommend trying to push one through in their town?
I would. I think it's a great thing to have because it's, for myself, I don't like riding on the road, the streets very much. You know, I'm concerned about traffic. So this is great, having this away from cars, and you don't have to worry about, you know, cars coming behind you and being concerned about, you know, crazy drivers or anything right. like that.
One of the things that has recently happened is the town of Arlington has just finished a 2-year master planning effort where we had outside consultants work with a variety of local organizations to see what could be done to improve Arlington's business districts. One of the things that we discovered through conversations with marketing professionals and urban designers was that the bikeway could be a major component of our economic development strategy. Yes, there may be 10,000 cyclists riding through town, but just imagine what would happen if each one of them spent a dollar on a cup of Starbucks coffee, for example. or some ice cream. Several businesses have opened up along the bikeway. Our local Ben & Jerry's in Arlington Center opened up an annex partway up the trail. And the owner of a heating oil company opened up a bicycle repair facility. We have taken counts, and one of the things we discovered was that on a good Saturday, Ben & Jerry's sold 1,500 types of ice cream in one day. That's one sale every 20 seconds that didn't take place before. We've also observed three or four new bicycle shops opening in Arlington, Lexington, and Bedford. And in fact, there's a major undertaking now in Bedford where there is a facility where you can rent bicycles and rent rollerblades. And it's there's a lot of congestion there on weekends.
Welcome back to Dead Air Live. We are here discussing bicycles in the community, and right there you saw a tape of some discussion in Danvers about a proposed rail trail conversion of a railroad track to a trail, and there was a lot of contention in the meeting. There were some concerns, and then after that you saw the Minuteman Trail, and Alan McLennan, who just spoke, was considered sort of the father of the Minuteman Trail. He spent 21 years, is that what you said? 21 years getting that thing off the ground. And he spoke there about the sort of positive effects on the business of Arlington, essentially, the economy of Arlington. But like I said, trails are very contentious. Now, there was just to talk about the people in Danvers, and they were concerned about people not seeing the bikers, being behind people's houses, being afraid of what's going to happen behind there. Taxes. What do you say to that? And what do you say when someone says it's going to raise our taxes?
It's also going to. If it raises the taxes, it's because it raises the value of their property. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a positive has a positive economic impact on a community. Mm-hmm. One of the common the themes from people who are opposed to trails, not only in this state but really everywhere around the country, are all the same. There are a few abutters, usually everywhere, who have they're really motivated by fear. For some reason, people don't seem to be concerned about an invasion of privacy by having a road go by in front of their house. But if there's a trail behind, I don't know what they do in their backyards. But to them, if they have some, the notion that people would be going behind their house seems to be frightening to some people. Mm-hmm. Although I can say on this, there's some interesting sort of anecdotal evidence. I've seen pictures of people whose houses back onto to a trail has been built, where there's been a fence built. Hmm. And you can see a fence, a nice high, 8-foot fence, maybe all the way along. And then the fence has been there for a while. In newer wood that's been recently put in, you can see where they've added a gate because they decided afterwards, hey, we want to get to this trail. So, it's everyone, and most places, everywhere that I know where there's a serious study has been done, where there was some concern ahead of time, once the trail has been in, there's overwhelming support for what is done to the quality of life in a community. Yeah. They are the primary benefit. The other real fear that some people talk about is that this trail is going to bring outsiders, going to bring in some people from other communities. This was one of the there were two high profile defeats for trails recently in Massachusetts. Belchertown out just east of Amherst, where they were looking for the extension of the Norwalk Trail. We can maybe look at it on a map in a minute. And then also Weston, which is one of the communities along a proposed 37-mile trail along the old Central Mass Rail Line, actually the same line that the Norwalk Trail is on. And clearly one of the concerns by people in Weston was that it was going to allow people from other towns to come into their community, as if the roads don't do that already.
Yeah,
I mean,
right,
that's
it's
fear. It's real. It's motivated by fear.
Right.
The truth is that the beneficiaries of a trail are the residents of a community. It
right.
becomes a major community resource that
right.
the town gets out and uses. Yeah, there may be a few people from the outside, but the people who use the trails are by and large good people.
Right.
They just ride through, and they're benign, and they come into the community. They sometimes stop at a trail and spend money at a store, buy mm-hmm. a soft drink, buy and it's a positive impact all around.
Right.
Yeah.
So.
Rest assured, if I'm going to steal your Magnavox, I'm going to use a car.
You want you to get away.
Yeah.
Apparently, we have a caller. So let me see if I can figure this out. We do not have a caller. Never mind. Okay, sorry. Weston was a. Well, I talked to the woman who wrote the opinion in Weston about, you know, basically saying that Weston should not adopt this trail. And their argument was that it's going to ruin conservation land, and you know, sort of drawing the parallel to the Minuteman Trail, you'd have, you know, tens of thousands. I mean, Minuteman Trail, let it be said, is one of the busiest trails in the country, right?
The busiest.
According to some counts.
And let's not forget, one of the reasons why it's one of the busiest trails is because at the moment it's the only trail within 128.
Right.
And so everybody gravitates towards this wonderful facility.
Yeah.
I mean, you go to Lexington Center and you see the people, you know, piling out of their cars and they're bringing their bikes. The more trails we have, the more you kind of tend to disperse some of that.
Right.
Scout troops are coming from Linfield and all over just to ride that trail now. Yeah.
And still, even so, if you did a poll of all the users of the trail, anytime you'd find that most of the users are still people from Lexington, Arlington, and Bedford.
Local
it's still local people who are the primary users.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, there are people from some other surrounding communities, but still, it's overwhelmingly the local people who benefit.
But I do, you know, you address the conservation issue. It's amazing to me the extremes people go to find boogeymen for something that is, you know, probably the most benign, proper use of public funds you could ever find.
Mm-hmm.
Conservation land. Well, where was this lady when they were flattening the wetlands to build a mall, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Again, it's just like Conrad said. They can do anything they want with a road and nobody seems to mind.
Mm-hmm.
They can widen highways, nobody seems to mind.
Mm-hmm.
You build a bike path and it's a crime rate, it's trash, it's going to do all this stuff. It's going to bring the immigrants in from the from the cities.
Right.
It doesn't bear out.
And just remember, this is going to be built on an existing there was a railway right of way there. And with a lot of ballast, I mean, it's not really making much of an impact on the land that's already there. So it's a bogus argument.
Right.
And anyone who's taken a walk down an abandoned rail right of way, they're not exactly, you know, pristine and safe.
Yeah.
Or, you know, that graffiti is not painted by people with expensive bikes.
Yeah.
Step over the
water heater around the appliances.
Right.
That's your railroad right away.
We got a call, but one point we should make is that studies have been made by the Rails to Trails Conservancy in Washington that trails actually decrease crime in
That's
communities.
True. Right. Mm-hmm.
But let's see if I can get this call here. Hold on. They hit that, and then. Hello.
Hi. Good evening.
Good evening.
Yeah, I'm watching the show, and I'm really interested because I grew up in the eastern part of the city for a long time. And I might have missed part of this because you had a map going. I hear that you're going to try to go through to Boston.
Yep.
And is that right now, I have a couple of questions, but is that, which line would that be? Would that be, I want to let you know I'm forward all the way, by the way. And but I was wondering, is that Tough Street or would that be near Lincoln Park or have they concluded?
No, it's not near, this is Greg Palmer speaking.
Sure.
That's the Fitchburg line. This is the one that goes behind the high school, behind the library, city hall. That's the Lowell commuter rail line, the one that's further out.
I think Tough Street goes to Lowell too, if I'm not mistaken.
Could be. I can't say I'm familiar.
Well, wait a minute. Boston and Maine.
Yeah, it is that rail. It's the commuter rail basically that goes to Boston.
But,
and you'll know it's like a 10-minute ride, by the way, on the train, so it's very direct.
And another thing I might add is that, as I hear, and you might have covered this, I might have missed this, but I don't know if lobby is the right word, but having people look at that tape of Lexington, we have friends out there and they love it because they can, like the gentleman said, he can go out the backyard and get exercise and everything.
Mm.
Also, where we don't have a limited amount of open space in the city, you beautify the bike path, what have you, with maybe different kinds of plantings for birds or just seasonal view. And maybe people would really appreciate it if those things were included, not only recreational, but you'd get all the people that love birds with you, and then open space issues, and just basically, like the gentleman said, you know, it's never going to hurt property values. And I would think it's exciting just to take your bike from one end of the area to another. I think it was something that some of them always missed.
Yeah.
To tell you the truth.
And, yeah, I mean, it lets you get out to the country, basically, right? I mean, you know, Bedford to Somerville. Yeah.
It's another. It's definitely another amenity, and yeah. I just want to let you know. I give you all the credit, and I hope that you know, you get all the support you should get, because, like I said, you know, that's what Somerville's always missed. I know I'm repeating myself, but I think it's great for exercise, and with so many cars on the road now, and all this exhaust and fumes and all this, that, you know, I just want to let you know that I think a lot of people that you don't even hear from are for it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just like somebody like myself that I turn on the TV and I see you going for
right,
it.
Yeah.
And I wish you all the best. It's
okay.
A great show.
All right.
And you can't miss with the pitches that, you know, you can bring right into Boston.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Have a nice evening.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Martin, I just would like to make one comment, and that is that a lot of this caller has talked about sort of wishing us the best of luck, like we're going to do this. And the point this to make is that this is a community resource, and it happens when people in the community stand up and work to make it happen.
Right.
So, you know, if it's one, it's great to say you like it, but you take the next step and go to a meeting when it's necessary, speak up. I mean, this is the issue of a vocal opposition. On trails is often, you know, right. Some people are more motivated when they're against something often than the people who are in general for it, but they don't quite feel the need to go out and speak up. And that's what we need to be. If you want it, stand up and you know, do what's necessary to make it happen.
Yeah. Just, I guess, will suffice it to say that there are a lot of trails in development. There's even talk of interconnecting trails, which would be really exciting. I think it would take a lot of the heat off of, or the traffic, really, divert a lot of the traffic from, say, the Minuteman onto other areas, which I think is pretty exciting idea. Karnad, one thing I did want to talk to you about, or just to hear a little bit about, you're very involved in statewide, we can call it advocacy,
right,
or whatever
it
you want to call it.
Yeah.
And just tell us a little bit about, you know, what's going on there.
Well, one of the statewide level, there was a reference earlier to the what's called the Bicycle and Pedestrian Access Law now, or
right.
The Paulson Bill. It was sponsored by Representative Ann Paulson of Belmont. It's been a law of the Commonwealth since May, Bike Month of '96. It has been actually it's viewed as a model law by many other states. We've gotten. Requests for a copy for the language, and there other people are trying to get a similar thing. Unfortunately, there haven't been many examples yet where the highway department has actually done the work to make a job that they're either overseeing or having the responsibility for really accommodate bicycles and pedestrians. The reason for that is not purely ill will on their part. It's that this involves doing something in a different way. They don't really know how,
right.
And it's easier to find a reason not to do it than to change.
Yeah.
But that's the setting to describe one of the things that's about to happen is that we are about now to get a statewide bicycle transportation plan, something that has been was mandated by some federal legislation. We played a very active role in the last few months putting an extensive set of recommendations in, and the word I have just earlier this evening, I was talking to one of the consultants working on the job, and I understand that probably in excess of 90% of our recommendations are going to be incorporated in this new plan. So we're very excited about that, because this is going to start this state on the right in the right direction, down the right path.
Well done. Do you just want to give us a flavor? Obviously, this is a big legislation, or I'm sure it's a complicated plan, but just want to give us a flavor of some of the things you're working on.
Well, it's a policy. What I can talk about what this plan is. This is going to there are over 20 discrete action items to say what agency is going to be responsible to accomplish what by a certain date, and this is all these 20 some items will all take place just in the next 18 months. Because one of the things that we're calling for is that a second generation plan needs to be drafted, which will be a much more comprehensive document to take effect January 1, the year 2000. This is really come about because I think we've had a slight change in administration with Governor Wells stepping down and now Acting Governor Salucci. We have a new Secretary of Transportation, Patrick Moynihan, who stepped into that role from previously being the chairman of the MBTA. So he already comes from a background that's thinking about another transportation from a different perspective.
Yeah.
And he, from everything we've heard, he is just 100% behind starting to do what do what needs to be done to make bicycling a thoroughly integrated part of our transportation system, mm-hmm. and that's what this plan will do. So you know I think we're going to see pretty dramatic. Dramatic changes from our point of view, because we feel that we're really working in a kind of partnership now rather than being sort of out on the outside,
right.
You know, beating on the door.
Well, congratulations. So we'll look for those changes. Just about the time to wrap up. I hope people in watching tonight have a sort of seen, you got a feel for all the things that, you know, that you're involved in, some of the activities you're involved in, paths, bicycle lanes and streets, just to make accommodating bicycles in general. I thank you all for talking. Just before, we're going to come back to the studio in a minute, but I got a tape from a Broadway Bicycle School on how to tune up your bike. It's springtime, so people should get out there, and we'll run just a piece of it, but let's just run it, tape from Broadway Bicycle School on how to tune up your bike.
Hi, welcome to Broadway Bicycle School. My name is Anne, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about our shop and also talk about bike maintenance, how you can get your bike in good working order. Broadway Bicycle School is a worker-owned business. We've been here for about 26 years, and we offer a number of options. We're a full-service repair shop. We sell new and reconditioned bikes and parts and accessories. We also offer instruction in bicycle repair. You can come in and work one-on-one with a mechanic to learn how to fix your own bike and pay $15 an hour, or if you already know how to fix your bike, you can come and use our tools for $6 an hour. And part of our reason for being here and the reason that we offer that service is so that we can get more people interested in riding their bikes, particularly using their bikes for commuting and for transportation, because it's a healthy alternative to depending on cars. It's good exercise for you. It reduces your stress. It's much less expensive than owning a car, and it's better for the environment and makes for more livable cities. We also offer classes in bicycle repair at night when we're closed, both beginning bicycle repair classes, advanced classes, and wheel building classes. So we encourage you to come on down and check us out. Now, some of the basic things that we encourage people to do for their bikes in order to keep them in good working order is to get a tune-up once a year. Different people will call different things a tune-up, so I want to explain a little bit about what a tune-up is here at Broadway. What we do in a tune-up is we first of all, adjust all of your rotational systems, all the places where the bike turns. There are ball bearings, and these areas need to be adjusted. So we adjust your front hub, your rear hub, your headset right here, and your bottom bracket, the place where the cranks come out, which the pedals are attached to. We also true your wheels, which means adjusting the spoke tension so your wheels don't wobble back and forth. We adjust both your brakes and adjust your gears, whether it be the two derailleurs or if you have a three-speed, the gears in the back. And then we also lube your bike and tighten everything down. So that's our tune-up. It's pretty thorough. And to keep your bike in good working order, we encourage you to do that once a year. Every other year, you ought to get an overhaul, which is a tune-up, as well as having the rotational systems overhauled. Rather than just adjusting them, we actually take them apart, examine the parts, replace anything that's worn, and put new grease and bearings in the rotational systems. Some of you who ride more than that, particularly people who commute or ride every day, may need some things in between. One thing that often people need to have done is have their wheels trued. If you ride a lot, especially in Boston and Cambridge, you'll be familiar with the potholes and the fact that they don't always pave that one side of the road near the sidewalk very well. So that may be something you need to do in between. So generally, you ought to expect to have to spend a little bit of money on your bike every year, like maybe $70 to $80 at least. But if you look at that next to what it would cost to maintain a car, it's pretty cheap.
Okay, well, welcome back to Dead Air Alive. We're just going to wrap up. I want to mention one thing before I thank my guests, is that it is Bike to Work Week in Boston, the week of May 18th and May 22nd. There is a festival in the square. It's rumored Tom Menino is going to show up, but who knows. So let me just thank people, and there is some contact information at the end of the show, but I just want to thank my guest, Greg Palmer. Thanks for coming on the Somerville Bicycle Committee. Mm-hmm. And if people want to get in touch with you, what should they do?
They can call the SERV, the Somerville Environmental Recycling Volunteers, phone number 628-8850, and we have a mailbox on there.
Okay, 628-8850. Mm-hmm. Conrad, thanks very much for coming. He's the executive director of BCOM, or Mass Bike. Mm-hmm. Which is the sort of the main bicycle advocacy group in the state.
If you want to get in touch with us, the office is in Cambridge. The number is 491-RIDE. We have a lot of members in Somerville. Greg is one of them. He's actually served on the board a few years ago. We are a membership organization, have over 1,000 members now. So hope that people will, if you're interested, get involved.
Yeah. Richard Fries,
from the Ride Magazine.
Editor of the Ride Magazine. You get a free subscription or half price if you join.
Our members get the ride at half price.
All right.
Good deal.
They do great work. I really encourage people to join Mass Bike. It's what we need a lot more of. If you want to get my magazine, any good bike shop has it.
Great. And Mike Alley?
I guess the final word is bicycling. Things happen, good things happen, because people get involved. So if you've liked what you've seen here, call people in Somerville, call people in Cambridge, and support, make it happen, show people you care.
All right, well, good way to end the show. We'll be flashing a couple of numbers after this, but thanks for watching. Hope everyone learned something tonight. Good night.